You're listening to the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast, a place for sex addicts to share their experiences of recovery, to help break the stigma, myths, and misconceptions of sex addiction. This podcast may contain topics of sexuality, sexual trauma, dysfunction, or other things that may be triggering. So listener discretion is advised. Hello, and welcome to the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast. My name is Jason, I'm a sex addict, and I will be your podcast host for today. How's it going, everyone? Welcome to episode 115 of the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast, and the last episode of 2023. This week, we'll be continuing our journey with AA historians and speakers, Joe and Charlie, and the big book Comes Alive. This one will focus on step two with chapter two, There is a Solution, and appendix two, The Spiritual Experience. On episode 109, I shared recordings of Joe and Charlie talking about sections of the AA Big Book, the foreword, and the doctor's opinion. The information they covered in those recordings do come back into the recordings for this episode. So if you haven't listened to it already, please check out episode 109 before listening to this one. And like that episode, several sections of the book and recordings focus on the specifics of alcohol and drinking rather than the universal message of the steps. So I've done my best to edit through that and focus on the recovery message and trying to keep it to about an hour. The trouble for me again was just where to start. I had not originally planned on covering chapter one, Bill's story, but there was some great information there that I wanted to include in this episode. Chapter two, There is a Solution, starts out with a wonderful analogy comparing the mixed fellowship of AA to the mixed group of shipwreck survivors like the Titanic. It's such a fantastic story, but I ended up trimming that section since it was about 10 minutes long itself. I also cut a few other stories talking about the specifics of drinking alcohol, but ended up keeping sections discussing moderate and heavy drinkers versus a true alcoholic with the allergy described in the doctor's opinion that we covered in episode 109. During their discussion of chapter 2, Joe and Charlie skip ahead to appendix 2 of the big book called Spiritual Experience. And this is ultimately the section that I wanted to share here on the podcast. I absolutely love that. So the big book Comes Alive is a 10-disc CD set that I have, and I've written down which chapters and pages are covered on each disc as a quick reference for finding specific information. On previous Joe and Charlie episodes, I had mentioned that I re-listen to these a lot and often share these with my sponsees. So in line with that thinking, I'll be adding some time codes in this episode for various sections of this recording covering Bill's story, There is a Solution, and The Spiritual Experience. And I'll put those in the show notes or the show description below. For the reading in this episode, I picked out a few from the big book covering a section of chapter two that I edited out, and in chapter one, setting up where this recording begins. So the first is from page 20 with a series of questions basically asking why you just can't quit. And again, we need to substitute drinking and alcohol with various aspects of sex addiction when we're thinking about this. So this is from page 20. How many times have people said to us, I can take it or leave it alone. Why can't he? Why don't you just drink like a gentleman or quit? That fellow can't handle his liquor. Why don't you try beer and wine? Lay off the hard stuff. His willpower must be weak. He could stop if he wanted to. She's such a sweet girl, I think he'd stop for her sake. The doctor told him that if he ever drank again, it would kill him. But there he is, all lit up again. Now these are commonplace observations on drinkers we hear all the time. Back of them is a world of ignorance and misunderstanding. We see that these expressions refer to people whose reactions are very different from ours. So I cut that section as right before they start talking about moderate drinkers. So the next reading is from Bill's story, and this is on pages 8 and 9, talking about Bill's friend Ebby Thatcher coming over to see him. So Ebby was his old drinking partner who had found sobriety through the Oxford group. So page 8, and I'll be skipping through a few things. So from the bottom of page 8, near the end of that bleak November, I sat drinking in my kitchen. With a certain satisfaction, I reflected there was enough gin concealed about the house to carry me through that night and the next day. My wife was at work. I wondered whether I dared hide a full bottle of gin near the head of our bed. I would need it before daylight. My musing was interrupted by the telephone. The cheery voice of an old school friend asked if he might come over. He was sober. It was years since I could remember him coming to New York in that condition. I was amazed. And I'm going to skip down a little bit. The door opened and he stood there, fresh skinned and glowing. There was something about his eyes. He was inexplicably different. What had happened? I pushed a drink across the table. He refused it. Disappointed but curious, I wondered what had gotten into the fellow. He wasn't himself. "Come, what's all this about?" I queried. He looked straight at me. Simply, but smiling, he said, "I've got religion." I was aghast. So that was it. Last summer, an alcoholic crackpot. Now, I suspected, a little cracked about religion. He had that starry-eyed look. Yes, the old boy was on fire, all right, but bless his heart, let him rant. Besides, my gin would last longer than his preaching. But he did no ranting. In a matter-of-fact way, he told me how two men had appeared in court, persuading the judge to suspend his commitment. They had told of a simple religious idea and practical program of action. That was 2 months ago, and the result was self-evident. It worked. And so those two gentlemen that were described there were from the Oxford group, a group that was practicing first century Christianity to the best of their ability, and in turn where a lot of the information covered in the steps comes from. So with that set up, here is Joe and Charlie, the big book comes alive, the end of Bill's story, there is a solution, and the spiritual experience. I hope you enjoy it.
Bill knew Ebby, and he knew how Ebby drank, and he knew that if Ebby was staying sober, some power greater than Ebby had to be working in Ebby's life. Whether Bill likes it or not is beside the point. Ebby is sitting there as living proof of it. That's what you and I have to offer today when we go out on a 12-step call. We're living proof that some power greater than human power is working in our lives also. Whether the newcomer likes it or not is beside the point. We are the living proof of it. Ebby was the proof of it to Bill. And he had to recognize that some power greater than Ebby had to be working in Ebby's life. Bill still doesn't like it. Let's go to page 12, first paragraph.
He said, "Despite the living example of my friend, there remained in me the vestiges of my old prejudice."
Now, old prejudice is old ideas. That's all prejudice is. It's old ideas.
"The word God still aroused a certain antipathy. When the thought was expressed that there might be a God personal to me, this feeling was intensified. I didn't like the idea. I could go for such conceptions as creative intelligence, universal mind, or spirit of nature, but I resisted the thought of the Tsar of the heavens, however loving his sway might be. I've since talked with scores of men who felt the same way." In other words, Bill's saying there's got to be a harder way to do this. "What you tell me is just too simple." Ebby was coming out of the Oxford group who was speaking about the letter of the law. Bill had been instilled by his grandfather about the spirit of the law. Two different thoughts.
I'd like to have been there that day. I'd like to have been sitting in the corner watching them. Now here's Ebby coming out of the Oxford groups, and he is on fire with this religious idea, trying to give it to Bill. Bill's sitting there about two-thirds drunk, been drunk for 3 weeks. And he's trying to resist everything that Abby's telling him. And they're sitting there talking and arguing back and forth about this God thing. And Bill's saying, man, don't tell me about a kind and loving God. Oh, yeah, I'll agree. It might be a great mind or a spirit of nature or something like that. But don't give me that God crap. And I guess Abby finally got tired of it. Let's look at the next statement very carefully. And if you'll notice, it is in squiggly writing.
That's italic.
My friend suggested what then seemed a novel idea. He said, why don't you choose your own conception of God? And the instant he said that, his message changed from a religious message to a spiritual message. Religion says this is the way you have to believe. Spirituality says it really doesn't make any difference how you believe. The only question is, are you willing to believe? Why don't you choose your own conception of God? And surely, 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 this opened the door for Bill Wilson. This little statement has opened the door for literally millions of we alcoholics. You let us have our own conception of God, everything's okay. I think the reason it works so good for we alcoholics is we don't have any problem with our own conception of anything.
My idea has got to be good.
Let us believe in God the way we want to believe in God. You bet you now then it's a different idea. Here's the effect it had on Bill. That statement hit me hard. It melted the icy intellectual mountain whose shadow I'd lived and shivered many years. I stood in the sunlight at last. It was only a matter of being willing to believe in a power greater than myself. Nothing more was required of me to make my beginning. I saw that growth could start from that point. Upon a foundation of complete willingness, I might build what I saw in my friend. Would I have it? Of course I would. And this is where Bill took step two. No step two written in those days. But this is where Bill came to believe that a power greater than himself could restore him to sanity or help him out of this situation. And if you'll notice, he said, upon a foundation of complete willingness, I might build what I saw in my friend. Now, this is Bill's first reference to a wonderfully effective spiritual structure. And he's going to start painting a picture in our mind using words. And he said, the foundation of that structure is willingness. Willingness comes from step one. When we can see that what we're doing is no longer going to work, that we're going to have to start trying to do something different, then we become willing to change. That comes from step one. Later on, we're going to see where believing, step two, will be the cornerstone of that wonderfully effective spiritual structure. Later on in step three, he's going to refer to it. Step three is the keystone of the new and triumphant arch through which we pass to freedom. Later on, he's going to tie that spiritual structure together through the asterisk to the appendix in the back of the book, The Vital Spiritual Experience. The beginning of the spiritual experience starts right here. We don't have to wait till we get to step 12 to get something. We start building it right here through willingness, step one, and then coming to believe in step two. Bill has now taken what we know today as steps one and step two. Abby immediately starts taking him to Oxford group meetings, but Bill's drunk. The allergies got him, and he can't stop. Finally, he has to go back in the town's hospital for the third time on page 13. Now, let's see on page 13 if we can't see the last 10 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. We see one and two. Let's look for the last 10.
He said, at the hospital, I was separated from alcohol for the last time. Treatment seemed wise, so I showed signs of delirium tremens. There I humbly offered myself to God as I then understood him to do with me as he would. I placed myself unreservedly under his care and direction. I admitted for the first time that of myself I was nothing. Without him, I was lost.
Now, the first step in the Oxford group that they had was surrender. And Bill is making his surrender here in the town's hospital. Later on, when he wrote the 12 steps, he knew no self-respecting alcoholic is going to want to surrender to anything. So he made that surrender into our step three, where we make a decision. We will make a decision, but we certainly don't want to surrender. So we see Bill there taking what we know today as step three.
He said, I ruthlessly face my sins.
Their next step that they had in the Oxford Group program was examine your sins. And Bill knew no self-respecting alcoholic was going to like the word sins. So he changed that to made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. We will take an inventory. There he's taking what we know today as step four.
And became willing to have my newfound friend take them away root and branch. I've not had a drink since.
Newfound friend, if you'll notice, friend is capitalized. He's referring to God here. And he's really referring to what later became steps six and seven. We became willing to have God remove these defects of character, and we humbly ask him to do so. There we see what later became steps six and seven.
My schoolmate visited me, and I fully acquainted with my problems and deficiencies.
They had a step they called confession and sharing. And no alcoholics wants to confess and share. So he changed that to we admitted to God, ourselves, and another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. There he's taking what we know today as step five.
We made a list of people I had hurt and toward whom I felt resentment. I expressed my entire willingness to approach these individuals, admitting my wrong. Never was I to be critical of them. I was to right all such matters to the utmost of my ability.
They had a step in the Oxford Group program called restitution. And no alcoholic likes the word restitution. So Bill took that and made it into two steps, step eight and nine. We made the list, became willing to the list, and then we began to make the amends wherever possible. There we see eight and nine.
I was to test my thinking by the new God conscience within. Common sense would thus become uncommon sense.
Now that's got to be step 10, where we continue to take personal inventory.
I would sit quietly when in doubt, asking only for direction and strength to meet my problems as he would have me. Never was I to pray for myself, except as my request bore on my usefulness to others. Then only might I expect to receive, but that would be in great measure.
That's got to be step 11, where we sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understand him, praying only for knowledge of his will and the power to carry that out. There we see step 11.
My friend promised when these things were done, I would enter upon a new relationship with my Creator, that I would have the elements of a way of living which answered all my problems.
That's got to be the first part of step 12, having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps.
Belief in the power of God, plus enough willingness, honesty, and humility to establish and maintain the new order of things were essential requirements. Simple, but not easy. A price had to be paid. It meant the destruction of self-centeredness. And I must turn in all things to the Father of Light who presides over us all. Poor old alcoholics got to give up the two most important things that we love most in this world. The first is our alcohol. The second is our self-centeredness, the things that we love so much. Simple, but not easy.
Bill said these were revolutionary and drastic proposals, but the moment I fully accepted them, the effect was electric. There was a sense of victory followed by such a peace and serenity as I'd never known. There was utter confidence. I felt lifted up as though the great clean wind of a mountaintop blew through and through. God comes to most men gradually, but his impact on me was sudden and profound. For a moment I was alarmed and called my friend the doctor to ask if I were still sane. And he listened in wonder as I talked. And finally he shook his head saying, "Something has happened to you. I don't understand, but you'd better hang on to it. Anything is better than the way you were." Now Bill always said that in the town's hospital he had a vital spiritual experience as the result of these steps, during which old ideas were cast aside and replaced with a new set of ideas. Now, we were not there to see that, and we don't know for sure what happened, but we do know this was about December the 13th or 14th of 1934. We do know that Bill didn't die until January of 1971. He never found it necessary to take another drink for the rest of his life. something profound took place in his life that day in the town's hospital as the result of these steps. This is why later on, when he wrote the big book, and he wrote how it works, he was able to say, these are the steps we took, which are suggested as a program of recovery. He took them in the town hospital using the Oxford Group program. Later on, he expanded them into the 12 steps.
Interesting to note that he called the doctor, whom he liked. He said, I was alarmed to call my friend the doctor, asked if I was still sane. He listened and wondered as I talked. Finally, he shook his head, saying, something's happened to you I don't understand, but you better hang on to it. Anything's better than the way you were. The good doctor knows, now sees many men who've had such experiences. He knows that they're real. The last conversation they heard from Dr. Silkworth, him telling his wife, we have to lock him up or turn him over to the insane asylum. Billy thought he'd gone insane when he had this experience. He asked the doctor, am I still sane? He said, yeah, you are, but you better hang on to whatever it is that happened to you. It's better. Anything's better than the way you were. Something very profound happened to Bill. For the last 2 or 3 days, with the help of Ebby, he went over what we know today as the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. The question is always asked, well, how long do I have to stay sober to go through the 12 steps? 2 or 3 days, be all right. You can always improve upon them as time goes by. But the quicker we go through them, the better off we're going to be through the first time. But something profound happened to Bill. He went into that hospital as a selfish, self-centered, egocentric maniac, alcoholic who couldn't stay sober. Something profound happened to Bill. He said, while I lay in the hospital, the thought came that there were thousands of hopeless alcoholics who might be glad to have what had been so freely given me. Perhaps I could help some of them. They, in turn, might work with others. He began to think immediately while he was in the town's hospital how he might help other people with the experience that he just had. Something profound happened to Bill that day.
My friend, and this time it's a small F, he's referring to Ebby. My friend had emphasized the absolute necessity of demonstrating these principles in all my affairs. Particularly was it imperative to work with others as he had worked with me. Faith without works was dead, he said, and how appallingly true for the alcoholic. For if an alcoholic failed to perfect and enlarge his spiritual life through work and self-sacrifice for others, he could not survive the certain trials and low spots ahead. If he did not work, he would surely drink again, and if he drank, he would surely die. Then faith would be dead indeed, and with us it's just like that. Bill spent the rest of his life trying to help other alcoholics, trying to help the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous, trying to put this thing together so that we could have it today. And during all of that period of time, he managed to stay sober. You know, he went to see Dr. Bob, not to sober up Bob. He went to see Dr. Bob to keep Bill Wilson from drinking. And if it worked for Bill Wilson in those days and the rest of his life, then surely, surely, it will work for us today. You know, I find in my own particular life, if I don't work with other alcoholics, if I don't get a little puke on me once in a while, I tend to forget where I came from. And when I forget where I came from, I start getting lost out there. And I start thinking like I used to think before I ever got sober. And next thing you know, I can be in serious, serious trouble. But if I stay active in AA, and if I'm continually working with other alcoholics, new people, I can never forget where I came from. And long as I don't forget where I came from, I'm going to stay sober. But let me feel, you know, we got good memories, we alcoholics have, but they're awful short when it comes to alcohol. And unless we're continually reminded of where we came from, then we're going to get in serious trouble. And I'm just like Bill. Working with others is absolutely imperative for me to do.
The work's hard, but the pay's good.
Alcoholics.
So the work's hard, but the pay's good. You get to stay sober.
Okay, let's take a little short break, and then we'll jump right on into Chapter 2. Let's take just about 10 minutes now is all. Okay. I can just see Bill as he writes the book, and as he finishes these chapters, he probably sits down and reviews it up to that point. He's probably able to say to himself now at the end of Bill's story, he can probably say, well, I was able to show them the problem in the doctor's opinion. I was able to give them an example of an alcoholic who had that problem in my story, Bill's story. And he probably says to himself, I think I've spent all the time I need to now in order to tell them what the problem is. And the next thing I need to tell them is, what is the solution to that problem? And as we've talked before, if the problem is powerless, then obviously the answer is going to lie within power. And he sits down and he writes chapter 2, There Is a Solution. And in chapter 2, he's going to talk about two powers. He's going to talk first about the power of the fellowship that supports us. But he's also going to tell us that that alone is not sufficient. That we're going to have more than just the power of the fellowship. And in the last half of this chapter, he'll talk about the power that changes us. The vital spiritual experience, similar to what he had in the town's hospital when he recovered. So as we go through this chapter, let's be looking for the two powers, and let's see why fellowship alone is not sufficient, and why it's really necessary to have the spiritual experience in order to recover from alcoholism. Chapter 2, There Is a Solution to that condition he's just described through the doctor's opinion and Bill's story. Joe?
And this guy that I sponsored, the name was Harold, and Thomas would have remembered Harold. Harold always kind of argued with, he said, there's as many different solutions as there are people in AA. And I said, well, Harold, if you look at the chapter heading on page 17, it'll tell you how many solutions there are. There is a solution, only one, but two different powers. The power of the fellowship that supports us and the power of the vital spiritual experience that changes us. So we start off here, it says we, there's that big word again. We of Alcoholics Anonymous know thousands of men and women who were just as hopeless as Bill. Nearly all have recovered. They have solved the drink problem. It says we're average Americans. Today I say we're average citizens of the world. I learned in Toronto there's 180 nations around the world that has Alcoholics Anonymous in it. So we're average citizens of the world today. All sections of this country and men's occupations are represented, as well as many political, economic, social, and religious backgrounds. We are people who normally would not mix. But there exists among us a fellowship, a friendliness, and an understanding which is indescribably wonderful. The fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. You heard it before the start of the study. The laughing, the joking, the hugging, the talking loud. That's the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. And I got sober on the fellowship. I felt good when I was at the fellowship. You know, the fellowship is very, very important. It says we're people who normally would not mix. As I look around the rooms here today, we're people who normally would not mix. We're probably the most mixed up group of people in Washington, D.C. here this morning. But there exists among us a fellowship and a friendliness which is indescribably wonderful. You see, the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous, extremely important.
The feeling of having shared in a common peril is one element in the powerful cement which binds us. But that in itself would never have held us together as we are now joined. The tremendous fact for every one of us is that we have discovered a common solution. We have a way out on which we can absolutely agree and upon which we can join in brotherly and harmonious action. This is the great news this book carries to those who suffer from alcoholism. Not the news of the fellowship, but the news of the common solution. And later on we're going to see where the common solution is the vital spiritual experience which comes about through the working and living of the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, I think one of the things that's our responsibility as older members to do is to say to the newcomer, you bet you, there's a lot of power in the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous. You bet you, that power will keep you sober for a period of time. But if you don't do more than just come to the fellowship, sooner or later, you're going to end up going back to drinking, and you're going to die from untreated alcoholism. The real solution of alcoholism lies within the vital spiritual experience through the working of the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. He gives us two powers here. The power of the fellowship that's going to support us, but the power of the common solution which is going to change us. Now, he's going to spend the first half of this chapter explaining to you and I why fellowship alone is not sufficient. And then he's going to spend the last half of this chapter explaining what the common solution really is. So let's look and see if we can't see why fellowship alone is not sufficient. Let's look at the drinkers that they would refer to. First one is
the moderate drinkers. Moderate drinkers have little trouble giving up liquor entirely if they have good reason for it. They can take it or leave it alone.
We talked about them last night. They're the ones that get a slightly tipsy, out of control, beginnings of a nauseous feeling. Alcohol is no big deal for them. If they have any problems with it, they'll just quit drinking, period. They don't have any trouble with it. Those expressions that Joe Dredd up here would refer to the moderate drinker. Now let's look at a second one.
Then we have a certain type of hard drinker. He may have the habit bad enough to gradually impair him physically and mentally. It may even cause him to die a few years before his time. If a sufficiently strong reason, ill health, falling in love, change of environment, or the warnings of a doctor becomes operative, this man can stop or moderate, although he may find it difficult and troublesome, and he may even need a little medical attention.
Now we call this guy the heavy or the hard drinker. They drink similar to we alcoholics drink, but they're not alcoholic. If a good enough reason presents itself, they'll do one of two things. They may learn to moderate their drinking. They do not have the physical allergy. They may quit drinking entirely. They do not have the obsession of the mind. They drink like we alcoholics drink, but they're not alcoholic. And you see them all the time. They're the ones that say, when I was in the service, I was an alcoholic also. And I got out of the service and I got married and went to church and quit drinking, and I don't see why you can't quit drinking. Those expressions that Joe read back here a while ago would refer to the heavy or the hard drinker too. But what about the real alcoholic? Now, he may start off as a moderate drinker, which many of us did. He may or may not become a continuous hard drinker. Many of us stayed periodic. But at some stage of his drinking career, he begins to lose all control of his liquor consumption once he starts to drink. Now we're going to describe the real alcoholic. Here's a fellow who's been puzzling you, especially in his lack of control. He does absurd, incredible, tragic things while drinking. He's a real Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
Anybody in here like that?
Yeah. Huh? Okay.
Charlie said last night that I drank moderately for a long period of time, then I crossed over that line into alcoholism. I don't know what line he was talking about, but I was drunk when I went over it. I know that.
He is seldom mildly intoxicated. He's always more or less insanely drunk. Anybody like that in here? He may be one of the finest fellows in the world, yet let him drink for a day, and he frequently becomes disgustingly and even dangerously antisocial. Anybody like that in here?
He's often perfectly sensible and well-balanced concerning everything except liquor. But in that respect, he's incredibly dishonest and selfish.
He often possesses special abilities, skills, and aptitudes. Has a promising career ahead of him. He uses his gifts to build up a bright outlook for his family and himself, and then pulls the structure down onto the head by a senseless series of sprees. Anybody like that in here? This is by no means a comprehensive picture of the true alcoholic, as our behavior patterns vary. But this description should identify him roughly. Now here's the question. Why does he behave like this? If hundreds of experiences have shown him that one drink means another debacle with all its attendant suffering and humiliation, why is it that he takes that one drink? Why can't he stay on the water wagon? The moderate drinker can, the heavy drinker can, why can't the alcoholic? What has become of the common sense and willpower that he still sometimes displays with respect to other matters? Perhaps there never will be a full answer to these questions. Opinions vary considerably as to why the alcoholic reacts differently from normal people. We're not sure why. Once a certain point is reached, little can be done for him. We cannot answer the riddle. We know that while the alcoholic keeps away from drink, as he may do for months or years, he reacts much like other men. We're equally positive that once he takes any alcohol, whatever, into his system, something happens, both in the bodily and mental sense, which makes it virtually impossible for him to stop. The experience of any alcoholic will abundantly confirm this. Now, these observations, the ones I just read regarding this real alcoholic, these observations would be academic and pointless if our friend never took the first drink, thereby setting the terrible cycle in motion. Therefore, the main problem the alcoholic centered in his mind rather than in his body.
Would you read that again, please?
Therefore, the main problem the alcoholic centers in his mind rather than in his body. You know, I can't get drunk if I don't take a drink. And I can't take a drink unless my mind tells me it's okay to do so. And always, just before I take a drink, I'm stone cold sober. No alcohol in my system at all. So my real problem centers in my mind telling me I can drink, rather than my body that ensures that I can't. If you ask him why he started on that last bender, the chances are he'll offer you any one of 100 alibis. Sometimes the excuses have a certain plausibility, but none of them really makes light in the havoc I think alcoholics' drinking bout creates. They sound like the philosophy of the man who, having a headache, beats himself on the head with a hammer so that he can't feel the ache. If you draw this fallacious reasoning to the attention of an alcoholic, he will laugh it off or become irritated and refuse to talk. Once in a while, he may tell the truth. You know, strange as it may seem, there are times when we alcoholics tell the truth, not too often, but once in a great while. And I had a lady in Al-Anon, her husband was still drinking, and she come to me one day and she said, "Charlie, all he does is lie, lie, lie." She said, "How can you tell when one of you guys are lying?" I said, "Lady, watch him closely. And if you see his lips moving, he's probably lying to you, all right." And then I said, "You want me to tell you how to keep him from lying?" And she said, "Yeah, yeah, yeah." I said, "Don't ask him those stupid questions." I said, "He has no more idea why he took that first drink than you have." Some drinkers have excuses with which they are satisfied part of the time, but in their hearts they really do not know why they do it. Once this malady has a real hold, they are a baffled lot. There is the obsession that someday, somehow, they will beat the game, but they often suspect they are down for the count. Now, there's the word obsession. And remember, an obsession of the mind is an idea that overcomes all ideas to the contrary. An obsession of the mind is an idea that is so strong it can make you believe a lie. And the great obsession of every alcoholic is someday, somehow, we're going to beat the game. Someday, somehow, we're going to find some kind of liquor we can drink without getting drunk. Someday, somehow, we're going to find a place we can drink it. Someday, somehow, we'll find a group of people. And that obsession is so strong that it makes us believe that it's okay to drink. And we take a drink, and that triggers the allergy, and then we get drunk. So the real problem centers in the mind telling us we can drink rather than the body that ensures we can't drink. Page 24, first paragraph, all squiggly writing.
The fact is that most alcoholics, for reasons yet obscure, have lost the power of choice in drink. Our so-called willpower becomes practically non-existent. We are unable at certain times to bring into consciousness with sufficient force the memory of the suffering and humiliation of even a week or a month ago without defense against the first drink. See, alcohol can't do anything to us unless it does something for us and say, I have a wonderful memory. It's just short when it comes to drinking. I can't remember the divorce court. I can't remember the car wreck. I can't remember the fights. Only thing I can remember when I'm getting ready to drink again is the sense and ease of comfort, which might come at once by taking a few good drinks. Drinking always changed the way that I thought and the way that I felt, you see. And we've already learned our willpower is practically non-existent, because when there's a battle going on between the willpower and the obsession of the mind, the obsession of mind will win out every time because it's stronger than my will. We're without defense against that first drink.
The almost certain consequences that follow taking even a glass of beer do not crowd into the mind to deter us. If these thoughts occur, they are hazy and readily supplanted with the old threadbare idea that this time we shall handle ourselves like other people. There is a complete failure of the kind of defense that keeps one from putting his hand on a hot stove. If you burned your hand on a hot stove, chances are you'll always remember that. Chances are you'll never go back and put your hand on a hot stove again, because you remember the pain and the suffering. You know, I remember back during the Depression years, back in the 1930s. There's a few of you in here old enough to remember those days too. And we didn't have very much in those days. We were so poor, as Joe says, that we spell poor with three O's in it. We were poor. And you didn't have hot and cold running water. You didn't have forced air heat. You didn't have all these things we got today. In the wintertime, if we burned whatever we could to stay warm. We burned wood, we burned coal, we burned walnuts, we burned whatever we could get our hands on.
Other people's houses, it didn't matter.
Other people's houses. But it didn't make any difference how poor you are. Cleanliness was still next to godliness. And everybody in the family had to take a bath on Saturday night. Whether you needed a bath or not is beside the point. Everybody takes a bath on Saturday night. One time in the middle of the winter, Mother had heated the bath water on the old heating stove sitting in our living room, put that water in a number 3 zinc wash tub sitting behind that old heating stove. Everybody in the family takes a bath in the same water. Now, I'm the baby of the family. Time it got to me, the crud would be about that thick on it. Mother said, get in there and get yourself clean. And I thought to myself, how in the hell do I get clean in there? But I didn't say that to Mother. You didn't talk to your mother that way in those days. And I scraped that crud back, and I got in that old tub full of water, standing there washing and soaping myself up, old heating stove right here next to me, red hot. And somehow I managed to bend over and stick my rear against that hot stove. Burned a blister on my rear end about as big as my hand. Hurt me worse than anything had ever hurt me up until that time. And do you know, I've never had an obsession of the mind to stick my ass on a hot stove since then. I can still feel it today. I know exactly how that felt. Now, alcohol has burned me over and over and over and over and over, just as bad as that hot stove ever burned me. But left on my own resources, I cannot remember what alcohol does to me, because I get to thinking about what it's going to do for me. And the idea of what it's going to do for me pushes out what it does to me, and I think it's okay to drink. And I end up drunk all over again. Complete failure of the kind of defense that keeps one from putting his hand on a hot stove. Page 24, last paragraph. When this sort of thinking is fully established in an individual with alcoholic tendencies, he has probably placed himself beyond human aid, and unless locked up may die or go permanently insane. Now, if we've placed ourselves beyond human aid, then the Fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous will not bring about recovery, because the Fellowship is made up of a bunch of human beings who are just as powerless over alcohol as I am. So if I'm going to recover, I've got to have more than just the Fellowship. Page 25. There is a solution to this deal that's just been described in the first half of this chapter. Even though we've placed ourselves beyond human aid, there is still a solution to the problem.
He said, almost none of us like the self-searching, the leveling of our pride, the confession of shortcomings which the process requires for successful consummation. I come into AA and I saw the steps on the wall talk about taking an inventory. I didn't want to do that. But I saw that really worked in others. I saw that people around the meetings that I was going to said that they had worked those steps. They had changed and they didn't want to drink anymore. And I wanted to be like them. But we'd come to believe in the hopeless and futility life that we'd been living in. When therefore we were approached by those in whom the problem had been solved, there was nothing left for us but to pick up the simple kit of spiritual tools laid at our feet. We have found much of heaven, have been rocketed, I like that idea, into a fourth dimension of existence of which we had not even dreamed. The great fact is just this and nothing less, that we've had deep and effective spiritual experiences. You notice that little asterisk right there? That wasn't in the first printing of the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous. People began to write into that little office and ask Bill what he meant by spiritual experience and spiritual awakenings and those things. They said, we're doing the same thing that you did, but we're not having those experiences. Are we doing something wrong? Well, Bill saw a little blank spot here. So in the next printing of the book, he put that asterisk right there. Bottom of the page, it said fully explained on Appendix 2. He wanted to make sure that we understand what he meant by those terms, spiritual experience and spiritual awakenings. Later on page 27, referring to the asterisk again, he said, for further application, see Appendix 2. Again, making sure that we understand what he meant by those terms. Page 47, it says, please see Appendix 2. We want to make real sure that we understand what he meant by those terms, the spiritual experience. And I had a misunderstanding about those terms of spiritual experience and spiritual awakenings. See, when I come to Alcoholics Anonymous, I had the spiritual knowledge of a seven-year-old boy. And way back when I was 7 years old, I told myself, if I ever get big enough they can't catch me, I'm not going to those churches no more. And I got big enough they couldn't catch me. And when I came to Alcoholics Anonymous, I had the spiritual knowledge of a seven-year-old boy. And you can imagine what it was. We used to have those revivals down there in the South a lot. My mother always went and tried to drag us kids there. They preached all day and they had dinner on the ground. They sang all night. Just boring, boring, boring. You know? Well, one night my Aunt Much, and that's the reason we call her Aunt Much because she's much of a woman. Aunt Much got into the spirit of that one night. And the next thing I know, she was jumping over those pews. And then she was rolling around in the sawdust. She began to talk in strange language that I never heard of before. And she was having a spiritual experience. And when they talked of a spiritual experience in this book, I thought that's what I was going to have. Now, I don't know about you, but I was dreading that. I didn't think I could do that. But for people like me, I told you, did I tell you I was been in ignorance all my life? Okay. For people like me, they put this in the back of the book to make sure that I understood what they meant by those terms. If I'm going to have a spiritual experience, it'd be a good idea if I understood what one of them was. Don't you think? So let's go back to page 569 and let's read about the spiritual experience. He said the term spiritual experience and spiritual awakenings are used many times in this book, which upon careful reading, and we know that alcoholics don't do careful reading, shows that the personality change sufficient to bring about recovery from alcoholism has manifested itself among us in many different forms.
I've already learned from that first paragraph something new. I've learned that it might be a spiritual experience or it might be a spiritual awakening. And in either case, it's going to be a personality change sufficient to bring about recovery from alcoholism. Our personality is made up by the way we think, by the way we feel, our ideas and attitudes toward life in general. So this spiritual experience or spiritual awakening will be a change in our personality, changing to something different than what we were when we first came here.
Dr. Silkworth called it a psychic change. Bill said a spiritual experience is a sudden type, happens right now like his was. spiritual awakening develops slowly over a period of a long time. We do better as we know better. But in any case, it's a change in our personality. Yet it's true that our first printing gave many readers the impression that these personality changes or religious experiences must be in the nature of sudden and spectacular upheavals. Happily for everyone, this conclusion is erroneous. That's why my Aunt Much had spectacular upheaval. Happily for everyone, this conclusion was erroneous. I'm glad to hear that. Now, the first few chapters, a number of sudden revolutionary changes are described. Though it was not our intention to create such an impression, many alcoholics have nevertheless concluded that in order to recover, they must acquire an immediate and overwhelming God consciousness, followed at once by a vast change in feeling and outlook. Among our rapidly growing membership of thousands of alcoholics, such transformations, though frequent, are by no means the rule. Most of our experiences are what the psychologist William James calls the educational variety, because they develop slowly over a period of time. Quite often, friends of the newcomer are aware of the difference long before he is himself. He finally realizes that he has undergone a profound alteration in his reaction to life, that such a change could hardly have been brought about by himself alone. What often takes place in a few months could seldom have been accomplished by years of self-discipline. With few exceptions, our members find that they have tapped an unsuspected inner resource, which they presently identify with their own conception of a power greater than himself, an inner resource. Remember that. Most of us think this awareness of a power greater than ourselves is the essence of spiritual experience. Our more religious members call it God consciousness. Most emphatically, we wish to say that any alcoholic capable of honestly facing his problems in the light of our experience can recover, provided he does not close his mind to all spiritual concepts. He can only be defeated by an attitude of intolerance or belligerent denial. We find that no one need have difficulty with the spirituality of the program. Willingness, honesty, and open-mindedness are the essentials of recovery, but these are indispensable. There is a principle which is a bar against all information, which is proof against all arguments, and which cannot fail to keep a man in everlasting ignorance. That principle is contempt prior to investigation. See, I knew so many things that were not true when I arrived here. It was almost impossible to learn anything that was true, because my mind had snapshot against so many things. I already knew it all, I thought. Didn't know nothing, but I didn't know that. I was unaware.
There seems to be one key word or one key idea running through this whole thing on spiritual experience, and that's the word change. Now, Bill Wilson repeats himself quite often in the Big Book. But when he does, he usually finds a different word, which means the same thing. Let's see how many times he said change on page 569 and how many ways he had of saying it. In the first paragraph, he called it a personality change sufficient to bring about recovery. In the second paragraph, he again said personality changes. But then he said, in the nature of a sudden and spectacular upheaval. An upheaval is to change something entirely. In the third paragraph, the first sentence, he said, sudden revolutionary changes. To revolutionize something is to change it entirely. Third paragraph, last sentence, he called it immediate and overwhelming God consciousness. To overwhelm something is to change it entirely. Third paragraph, last sentence, he called it a vast change in feeling and outlook. Fourth paragraph, first sentence, he said such transformations. To transform is to change. About the middle of the fourth paragraph, he called it a profound alteration. To alter is to change. So the key thing in this whole thing is to change from what we were when we came here to something entirely different. We come here restless, irritable, and discontented. We come here filled with shame, fear, guilt, and remorse. We come here very selfish, self-centered, dishonest, self-seeking, frightened, and inconsiderate human beings. And because of those conditions, that always led us back to drinking. Now, if we can change from that to something entirely different, we will have changed our personality sufficient to bring about recovery from alcoholism. And that's all this spiritual experience is, has nothing to do with religion. I'm exactly like Joel. You know, I thought it was some great religious thing that you had to have. Has nothing to do with religion. A change in personality sufficient to recover from alcoholism.
I told you when I first got here, I stood in the back of the rooms and I looked down at my feet and I was ashamed. I'd become everything I detested in a human being, and I didn't like me at all. And I knew if you knew me, you wouldn't like me either. So when they began to talk about change, I became interested in that. I wanted to change. So what I did, I looked around the halls of Alcoholics Anonymous, and I found me some heroes. I think we all do that, and I think it's necessary for a while. Charlie was one of my heroes. So I did everything I could do to be like Charlie. I almost made it. Good thing I didn't. But I emulated other people trying to change and be like, I didn't want to be like me. I want to be like you. See, and I tried to change. But I think the type of change that you're really talking about today is to change from what I had become to that which God intends for me to be. That's a marvelous experience in Alcoholics Anonymous that we must not miss. To be that which God intends for us to be. And he didn't make no junk, you see.
Let's go back to page 25. That second paragraph. The great fact is just this and nothing less. That we have had deep and effective spiritual experiences. Now, what did they do? Which have revolutionized or changed our whole attitude toward life, toward our fellows, and toward God's universe. The central fact of our lives today is the absolute certainty that our Creator has entered into our hearts and lives in a way which is indeed miraculous. He has commenced to accomplish those things for us which we could never do by ourselves. If you are seriously alcoholic as we were, we believe there is no middle-of-the-road solution. We were in a position where life was becoming impossible. And if we'd passed into the region from which there is no return through human aid, we had but two alternatives. One was to go on to the bitter end, blotting out the consciousness of our intolerable situation as best we could.
Which is step one.
And the other to accept spiritual help.
Which is step two.
This we did because we honestly wanted to, and we were willing to make the effort. You know, a lot of people in AA today say you better not talk too much about God, or you'll run the newcomer off. And you notice the big book doesn't mind talking about God at all. The big book finally gets around to telling us we just got one of two alternatives. We can continue to drink until we die from alcoholism, step one. Or we can accept spiritual help, step two. And it seems as though there's no other decisions for us to make except between those two. My old sponsor helped me out in this area. He said, Charlie, you don't need to worry about running a newcomer off talking about God. He said, if you do, whiskey will put him right back in here. And said, when he comes back, he'll probably be willing to talk about God. He was exactly right.
There's no door three. This is one or two. Everybody has to make that decision. I can't make it for them. And the question is, if they run them off, where are they going to go? Where are you going to go? If this don't work, where are you going to go? There's no place else. This is it. It's the last house on the block. This better work or we're all doomed. Thank God it does work.
Now, you would think, and I thought for a long time, that this idea of the great spiritual experience would have come from somebody in religion. And I'm always amazed when I look at this example on page 26 to see where this really came from. A certain American businessman had ability, good sense, and high character. Now, this is the guy named Roland Hazard. For years, he had floundered from one treatment center to another. He had consulted the best-known American psychiatrist. Then he had gone to Europe, placing himself in the care of a celebrated physician, the psychiatrist Dr. Jung, who prescribed for him. Now, he didn't go to Dr. Jung for a 28-day treatment program. He was there for a full year with Dr. Jung. They had a session every week. Though experience had made him skeptical, he finished his treatment with unusual confidence. His physical and mental condition were unusually good. Above all, he believed he had acquired such a profound knowledge of the inner workings of his mind and its hidden springs that relapse was unthinkable. Nevertheless, he was drunk in a short time. More baffling still, he could give himself no satisfactory explanation for his fall. So he returned to this doctor whom he admired and asked him point blank why he could not recover. He wished above all things to regain self-control. He seemed quite rational and well-balanced with respect to other problems, yet he had no control whatever over alcohol. Why was this? He begged the doctor to tell him the whole truth, and he got it. In the doctor's judgment, he was utterly hopeless. He could never regain his position in society and would have to place himself under lock and key or hire a bodyguard if he expected to live long. That was a great physician's opinion. But this man still lives and is a free man. He does not need a bodyguard, nor is he confined. He can go anywhere on this earth where the other free man may go without disaster, provided he remains willing to maintain a certain simple attitude. Now, some of our alcoholic readers may think they can do without spiritual help. Let us tell you the rest of the conversation our friend had with his doctor. The doctor said, "You have the mind of a chronic alcoholic. I've never seen one single case recover where that state of mind existed to the extent that it does in you." Our friend felt as though the gates of hell had closed on him with a clang. He said to the doctor, "Is there no exception?" "Yes," replied the doctor, "there is. Exceptions to cases such as yours have been occurring since early times. Here and there, once in a while, alcoholics have had what are called vital spiritual experiences. To me, these occurrences are phenomena. They appear to be in the nature of huge emotional displacements and rearrangements.
Change.
Ideas, emotions, and attitudes that were once the guiding forces of the lives of these men are suddenly cast to one side.
Change.
And a completely new set of conceptions and motives begin to dominate them.
Change.
In fact, I've been trying to produce some such emotional rearrangement within you.
Change.
With many individuals, the methods which are employed are successful. But I've never been successful with an alcoholic of your description. Asterisk, bottom of the page, for amplification, see Appendix 2. Yeah. Can you just imagine the humility of this doctor? In those times we're referring to, there was three leading psychiatrists in the world. Dr. Freud, Dr. Adler, and Dr. Jung. Adler and Jung were both students of Freud. Jung had fallen out with Dr. Freud and Dr. Adler on one thing and one thing only. Freud and Adler believed that all answers would lie within the mind. Dr. Jung believed that some answers might come through spirituality. You know, thank God Roland didn't get to Freud or Adler. We'd still be sitting around psychoanalyzing ourselves, which unfortunately some AA meetings are doing that. Thank God they got to Dr. Jung. You know, he could have said, "Roland, I believe you're suffering from a Valium deficiency. Let me write you a prescription. And you keep coming back, and we'll treat you for another year." Roland had plenty of money. But this little doctor was great enough to say, "Roland, I've done all I can do for you. I can't help you anymore. With all my knowledge of the mind, I've done all I can do for you, and you are probably going to die from alcoholism." And Roland said, "Are there no exceptions to that?" And he said, "Oh, yeah. Once in a great while, alcoholics of your description have had vital spiritual experiences." He said, "They're phenomena to me. I don't understand them. But they appear to be in the nature of huge emotional displacements and rearrangements. Ideas, emotions, and attitudes. For once the guiding forces of the lives of these men are cast to one side and replaced with a new set of ideas, emotions, and attitudes. And Roland said, oh, great, I'm a church man. And Jung said, no, that's not going to work for you. You're going to have to do something different. Now, we don't know whether he told him to go to the Oxford groups or not. But we know that Roland got in the Oxford groups, used their program of action, had a vital spiritual experience, took that to Abby Thatcher. Abby Thatcher took that to Bill Wilson. And this whole thing started from this little guy back here. When I look at these 12 steps, and I really think about where they came from, it just absolutely blows my mind. You know, step one came to us from a non-alcoholic doctor in New York City called Dr. Silkworth. Step two came to us from a non-alcoholic psychiatrist on the other side of the world over there in Switzerland. The last 10 steps came to us from a group of non-alcoholic people who were practicing first century Christianity to the best of their ability. You know, Bill always said, when he wrote the 12 steps, he said, I knew none of these things. And he said, all these ideas from these diverse places entered into my mind. And from there, I was able to write the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. And they all came from non-alcoholic people. We're proud of our 12 steps, and we ought to be. But we need to remember where they came from. And they really came to us from non-alcoholics. None of them came to us from alcoholics. Blows my mind every time I think about that. I
think about the slender threads of AA. Roland came home and ultimately stayed sober about 3 months. His family was so happy that he was staying sober that they gave him a little vacation up in Vermont. And they said, go up there and spend some time and enjoy yourself. Take a couple of friends and have a good time. The two friends that he took were Seber Graves and another guy named Chip, who were all the members of the Oxford group. The slender thread was that the little friend that he took with him, his father happened to be the judge who had Abby Thatcher in jail, who was getting ready to commit him to hospital for alcoholic insanity. It had that guy not stayed sober for 3 months, had that family not gave him a little vacation, had he not picked two friends to go with him, one of them's judge, dad was the judge, we may not be here. Slender threads, little things is happening. We see the hand of God all through this book. You see, I believe that Alcoholics Anonymous started right over there when Roland was told by Dr. Jung that here and there, just once in a while, alcoholics have what we call a vital spiritual experiences. To me, these are phenomena. I don't understand it, but I know they exist. Today, as we sit around these rooms today, we can look at each other and say with assurance that here and now, every time an alcoholic will apply these things to their life, they too can recover. I see the hand of Alcoholics Anonymous all through this book, don't you? See? And it started way back over there. Silkworth knew what the problem was, but he didn't have a solution for it other than just don't drink. Dr. Jung had the solution, but he didn't know what the problem was. The Oxford group had a planned program of action. They weren't interested in the solution at all. You see? All this information gelled in the mind of one person, Bill Wilson, and he put it down on this book so that we too could learn what he learned.
Is that odd or is that God?
Is that right?
I love that recording. Like I had mentioned earlier, I go back and listen to these quite often, especially the section on Appendix 2, The Spiritual Experience. And I believe that I've read some of that on other episodes of the podcast. So for the next Joe and Charlie episode in the series, we'll still be covering Step 2, and it will be on Chapter 4, We Agnostics. So look for that one in the future. And since this recording was a lot longer than I had anticipated, and it's almost New Year's Eve, I will forego reading listener email, but I did have one song that I wanted to share, which is particularly fitting to this episode, and that is 46 and 2 by Tool. So there have been many interpretations of the song, but ultimately it is about change. Thinking about what Joe and Charlie were talking about here at the end of this recording and the spiritual experience and change. And just recently, I looked back at our old podcast episodes, and exactly 2 years ago, I released episode 42, Don't Be Afraid of Change, which also featured songs about change as we get ready for a new year. So Joe and Charlie were talking about Dr. Carl Jung, whose thoughts on shadow self play into Tool's song 46 and 2. We all have a shadow self, and it's generally made up of parts of ourselves we deem unacceptable. This is Jungian theory on the shadow self. For many people, this means things like our sadness, rage, laziness, and cruelty, things like that. 46 and 2 is about growing, changing, and moving towards the next level of human evolution and consciousness. The 46 refers to the 46 human chromosomes and adding two new chromosomes to bring on a further metamorphosis. The song is also deeply rooted in Jungian theory. It is believed that you cannot reach this new level of evolution without first delving into yourself and basically cleansing your consciousness for the next jump. And that's where the shadow comes in. The shadow is basically everything that is unseen that you're uncomfortable with, so kind of stepping through that shadow. So with that, here is 46 and 2 by Tool. Such an awesome song. And yes, like many other Tool fans, I love geeking out on interpretations of their songs. But yeah, 46 and 2 is a fan favorite, one of their most popular songs. And like I mentioned before, I will be reading more listener email and song suggestions on the next episode of the podcast, which will be an Experience, Strength, and Hope share that we recorded at the noon Zoom meeting. And since that one is a shorter recording, I'll have a lot more time to respond to emails and share other music from listeners. So if you did wish to provide feedback for the podcast, you can email us at feedback@sexaddictsrecoverypod.com, or you can email me directly at jason@sexaddictsrecoverypod.com. If you have any questions about the podcast or the program, or if you want to be a future guest. Like I had been mentioning on the past few episodes, I will start to schedule new recordings in January. And we have had so many new requests coming in, so please bear with me and I will get back to you, all of you who have asked to share your stories here on the podcast. I'm super grateful for all of those. Speaking of gratitude, I thank you so much for listening and wish everyone a wonderful new year. And with that, I will close it out. So thanks for tuning in this week. And as always, keep coming back. The views and opinions contained in the Sex Addicts Recovery Podcast are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect those of the Bay Area Intergroup or the ISO of SAA.